Holston Films production.
Welcome back to another thought-provoking edition of Video View. This is part two, and we're looking for physical violence between Julia Fordham and Blackie Lawless. And who better than to provide us with physical violence than the Proclaimers, who are back. Yes, Craig and Charlie Reed are back with another sizzler from the Sunshine on Leith album, which has already gone platinum. It's called I'm On My Watch Out My Way. Yeah, platinum out. That album's platinum in the UK. The Proclaimers, there, Sunshine over Leith. Julia,
well,
what about
I just,
the Proclaimers?
Well, obviously, I think they're splendid. Blackie hates them. He's shaking his head. He's nearly in tears. I really like the spirit of the Proclaimers. I think that they do really good videos. They're very consistent. They get my vote. Blackie's about to hang himself, or
there
me.
There is no justice in this world. None whatsoever.
Well, why?
The revenge of the nerds pick up guitars and make millions.
If these guys are nerds, what was that tosser who has the Elvis problem? I mean, you know, which you
well,
sat
I didn't say
through
he wasn't either. Entire, I just thought it was entertaining.
The entire video. I mean, I think they're entertaining, and I like them.
Would you like to go out with one of them, or what? I think Blackie has
a problem, right? He doesn't like homosexuals. He doesn't like guys who wear glasses.
I didn't say glasses, or glasses, however you want to pronounce it. You were giving it nerdy, weren't you?
Well, implying that they were a bit nerdy.
And I'll tell you what, Blackie, look, don't worry, we've got a Samantha Fox video coming up shortly, all right?
Lord.
Okay. But anyway, before all that happens, there's a four-piece from Harleysville, USA. They're called the Dead Milkmen. They share the same label as Mr. Mojo Nixon. The track's called Punk Rock Girl.
Saturday, I took a walk to Zipperhead. I met a girl there and she almost knocked me dead. Punk rock girl, please look at me. What do you see? Let's travel around the world, just you and me, punk rock girl. I tapped her on the shoulder and said, do you have a bell? She looked at me and smiled and said she did not know. Punk rock girl, give me a chance. Let's go slam dance to a dress like Minnie Pearl. Just you and me, punk rock girl. We went to the Philly Pizza Company and ordered some hot tea. The waitress said, well, no, we only have it iced. So we jumped up on the table and shouted anarchy. And someone played a Beach Boys song on the jukebox. It was California Dreamin'. So we started screaming on such a winter's day. She took me to her parents for a Sunday meal. Her father took one look at me and he began to squeal. Punk rock girl, it makes no sense. Your dad is the vice president, rich as the Duke of Earl. Yeah, you're for me, punk rock girl. To a shopping mall and laughed at all the shoppers and security guards. To a record shop, we asked.
Yeah. Anything for you, Blackie.
I'm sure.
Why don't you sit on his lap, Julia? Girl?
I'm tempted.
You would never survive it.
This
is great. This is great. These guys remind me of a story of a friend of mine who said he was going to play drums for 2 weeks and he'd be ready for punk rock. I mean, I love the guitar solo and it reminds me of the old Dr. Hook song, Rolling Stone. It was great.
I like that. I thought they were quite funny. Could you stay awake, Paul?
No, I just really started to meet Dr. Hook. I thought, God, who's that? You know, blimey.
Back in the olden days, though.
Yeah, back in the olden days.
Should see a doctor about that.
It's terrible, but super glue, can't move. So the Dead Milkmen, bit of a rocking success, don't you think?
I thought so.
Yeah. It looks like Tijuana had finally got enough money to make a video. You know, that guy there with a guitar in the middle. Well, you guys wouldn't understand that. You don't know what Mexico is.
You don't understand,
right?
anything you're saying, Blackie, quite frankly.
No, no, it's good to have you here. And now, just before Christmas, some of you might have been lucky to see the Smiths, minus Johnny Marr, reform for a one-off date in Wolverhampton, which proved a great success. Now it's back to Morrissey. He's got a new single on general release, Last of the International Playboys. What I meant was, sure, go and hit your button, but I didn't mean... anyway, okay, fine. So what about that overtly homosexual? There's a boy wearing underpants in there.
I know, I was a bit worried. I mean, you lasted as long as you did.
I don't think it should be allowed.
Well, I told her I didn't wear any underpants at all, so that makes it right.
I told him that we had actually noticed.
Yeah. Well, no,
can you tell... So in other words, you can tell that I am Jewish, right?
Yeah. He wears ankle-length underwear,
this boy.
It's a can of hairspray, that's what it is. So you can whip it out.
Right. Yeah. That's right. I never leave home without it.
Well, back to our dear friend Morrissey then.
Yes, that would be quite nice, I think. Whilst Julia pauses for thought, Blackie, maybe you
can... Her neck's going to, like, freeze in that position.
Yeah,
reminds me of somebody I saw last night.
I'm sure you know a good massage technique you could help her out with. So what about that then? Morrissey, you know Morrissey the Smiths, one of the biggest rock and roll bands of our time?
No, I didn't.
Didn't think you would. Julia?
I'm not a huge Morrissey fan, although I think he's very clever. I do think he's very good at writing those songs. And let's face it, that tune works for him every time. I mean, he's interesting.
Do you think he's still there, though? I mean, Morrissey, you know, the Smiths reforming, what about it? Is it sort of, you know, dragging out the old dinosaurs?
No, I think he's still got it. In fact, I probably prefer this one to some of the others.
I think you've still had it for quite a while. Blackie, you just have to talk about,
you know,
sort of...
He has got something, Morrissey.
If he's an international playboy, I'm Mahatma Gandhi, I'll tell you. You know, I mean, like, no, I don't buy it. I can't even believe we're sitting here talking about this. I'd really get on to that.
Yeah, but he was being clever. Morrissey was being clever. He was saying, you know, I'm not really an international playboy.
I think we'll be able... Yes, it's a bit of satire.
Do you have irony in America?
They don't have irony or satire.
No, it's something you do your trousers with,
yeah,
right?
Well, no, yes, obviously not in your case. No creases on Blackie. Now, obviously, I think we can predict the response we'll get from Blackie Lawless to this one, because it's Samantha Fox. With her follow-up to the Love House single, also taken from the I Wanna Have Some Fun album, which is reaching gold in the United States as a cover of a 60s hit, I Only Want to Be With You.
Oh, no. Okay, I was being controversial there, and I biffed it off because I knew that Blackie would love to see it to the end, because he'd been getting very excited knowing that Sam was about to bare her cellulite to the world.
My tongue's getting hard.
I've seen this video before, which is one of the reasons why I stopped it. And
sure you did.
I have. I saw it the other day on Top of the Pops or something, and I felt that... I did. I thought... Look,
yeah, I did that show. Don't do that. You know.
And I feel that... I know that my 1988 New Year's resolution was, I know for last year, that I was going to give women like this support. And I've changed my mind in 1989, quite frankly. I just think it keeps... you know, that whole image of
the suspenders
in the
beds.
It's what I live for.
It's what you live
for. It's actually
for.
A good song, though. It really is.
It's a great song. It's a great song.
So why don't you just listen to it, not watch it?
Because I don't think it's done particularly well. I mean, I think
it's a matter of taste.
I've preferred many of the other versions. Mm. This is not a hot favorite
for me. But Samantha's quite credible in the States, isn't she? She's a big dance floor success. I mean, what's her
image? She's a real big dance floor success.
Yeah,
right?
What a cracker!
Come on.
You know, what is her image out there? Seriously, is it all sexy?
It's the same as it is here.
Which is?
About 30
I don't know, she came from here, you tell me.
No,
she's not known for what she is over
here, really.
Well, it's because from where she came from, but the people in the States don't know that. I mean, they don't know what Page Three is over there. So the only thing they know is music,
Do you go down the clubs and get rock into that kind of groove?
No, but I mean, I do music for a living, you know, and it is a good song.
Yeah. It is a good song, yeah.
Good. Well, good old Samantha. Now, I think there's barely time to get a snatch of Nizza Ebb, Chelmsford's finest sons, who are just about to head off into Europe. They leave us with the first release of their brand new album. It's called Belief. The track is called Hearts and Minds.
Then.
No, as I said, we only had time for a snatch because we've got less than a minute till the end of the show, so I thought I'd do that. But you did see a bit of it, didn't you?
Well, I was so excited about Blackie coming over and sitting here next to me, in fact.
Yeah, I wanted to take this right there.
I barely knew where to start.
Well, can we maybe talk about something? I mean, Nizza Ebb, a brilliant group, they'll go far, but we didn't really get much
actually,
on that.
Actually, that's really ticklish. So,
let's just finish with a few key comments from Blackie and Julia. Choose a topic, whatever you want to talk about, really. Julia.
Just down a little further, that's all.
We're being reunited.
So, Julia's off to do her album. Blackie, you'll be back to tour.
I'm back to tickle her, that's what I'm back to do. I'll be back here in April.
Yeah, we'll be throwing your meat around on stage again.
Never mind. I'm not going to touch that for nothing.
You're getting a bit more serious about your music now, aren't you? No, Judith's certainly not going to touch that. But you are getting a little bit more serious about the music, aren't you?
No. This is a very social conscious record that we've done. Believe it or else.
Yeah, I don't believe it. Judith Paulin, thanks so much for coming in. And Blackie, I hope you soon find a cure for that bad case of homophobia. Right?
Yeah, me too.
Right. It's been a great pressure. Thank you very much.
So, there we go, another thought-provoking video of you. Join us next week. Coming up in the show, Annabelle talks to Dusty Springfield. I'll be talking to the
Queen.
Muses.
Don't say Queen.
No, don't say that.
In the city sits an eagle astride a star.
I'm going to have another coffee.
Plumbers. I'm serious. 20% of our home insurance claims come from burst pipes.
So what do? Give our clients the name of a plumber?
And most of the damage is caused because it takes so long to find someone to fix the pipe.
Okay. Find a way to do it.
Special helpline, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Help straight away. So less damage.
Good. Especially the less damage.
The Home Star policy helplines are just one of the ideas from Eagle Star that are changing the way people think about insurance. Eagle Star, always a good idea.
On with a quick fire section, fingers on the buzzers. Who was Britain's last coalition prime minister? Contestant number two.
Winston Churchill.
Correct. Gozzers, pinkies and... Contestant number two?
Types of fishing bait.
Correct. Who discovered number two again?
Louis Pasteur.
Correct. Where might...
In your ear.
Correct. What...
Seven.
Huh?
Runner beans?
What...
H2O.
Yeah, I bet he drinks Carling Black Label.
Your best bet for a fuller flavour.
Carling Black Label.
Bored, tired, lonely, depressed? Well, sod off with, aren't you, watching Night Network?
What's your idea of a nightmare? Non-stop Carly Minogue? Waking up in hospital after an accident to find Fergie visiting you? Being force-fed omelettes by Edwina Curry? Well, these all pale into insignificance against the well weird dreams the frightfully, frightfully about Diana, played by Gemma Redgrave, is having in Dream Demon in the run-up to her wedding. Freud would have a field day with her after dark apparitions, gigantic creepy crawlies, walls dripping blood, and general yuckiness everywhere. Her doctor reckons it's all to do with repressed sexual feelings or some such nonsense as she hasn't, you know, done it with her posh boyfriend. And when you see the snotty git, you'll understand why. Diana's dreams start to get even worse when Jenny, a kooky American chick who looks like an unfortunate mating between a bottle of Indian ink and an ironing board, comes to stay. She lived in Diana's home as a child and now wants to trace her ancestry. From then on, life is just a bed of neurosis for Diana. Not only is she plagued by these dreadful dreams, which are now coming true, she's also followed by two reporters so utterly gruesome even Fleet Street wouldn't hire them. They're brilliantly played by Jimmy Nail and Tim Spall, who obviously likes his chin so much he grows three more during the film. Dream Demon is a gruesome yet stylish thriller, and what makes it so effective is that you're never quite sure whether Diana is in the real world or in her, one of her nightmares. In fact, the only disappointing thing is the performance of Gemma Redgrave, an obvious graduate of the Roger Moore School of Dramatic Art, as her expressions tend to range only from bland to very bland. Here's Diana in a style of marriage ceremony that probably won't catch on.
Do you take this man to be your lawful wedded husband, to have and to hold, to love and to cherish, in sickness and in health, till death do you part?
I can't. Diana, what are you saying?
I'm sorry, Oliver. I can't marry you. I can't explain right now. I just can't.
Are you mad? How can you do this to me in front of my whole family? And the Admiral?
I'm really very sorry. Something's happened.
How dare you humiliate me like this?
Versa is one of those life swap movies Hollywood has been so keen on recently. Judge Reinhold plays Marshall Seymour, a hard-headed businessman who on one of his many trips abroad comes home not with a ginger jar as intended, but a gold skull he's picked up on the plane by mistake, which bears a startling resemblance to Bridget Nielsen in a German helmet. Whilst fighting at home with his son Charlie, Fred Savage, he tells him he should try being in his place and vice versa. And of course that's what happens thanks to the voodoo powers of the magical skull thingy. Marshall now has to cope with life back at school in his son's body, whilst Charlie is left to fend for himself in his dad's cutthroat business world, and of course he also inherits his dad's girlfriend. Vice Versa is quite entertaining though, quite predictable, but there are some great moments, such as when Charlie gets his own back on the school bullies by pretending to be from a school vice squad. My only gripe with the film is that the Savage plays Charlie as a sussed out 11-year-old, yet when Reinhold becomes him, he's a breathless brat who has a penchant for saying, gee, that's gross, and what a spaz. Here's the lads doing their incredible Hulk impressions.
You think I can ever go back to that restaurant again? After your friend went table hopping?
Stop dumping on me, Dad!
I'm not dumping on you. I've been up since 6, and I have a very tough day ahead.
Well, I have a pretty tough day ahead, too.
You're going to school, for God's sake. School is games and fun and goofing off. It's the best time you'll ever have in your life.
You mean it gets worse?
Wait till you have to make a living. You'll find out how much worse. I told you to leave that alone.
You don't have to take tests at work. And I bet people don't push you around calling you shrimp and microbe. You know, I wish I could change places with you.
Yeah? Well, I wish I could, too.
Huh?
Now, here's a chance to get your own back and some of the arty cinemas who charge a fortune to see one of the best French films ever made. Jean de Florette is now out on video, so you can watch it in the comfort of your own home, rather than in some drafty cinema surrounded by film snobs who quibble over the inherent aesthetic value of the subtitles. Jean de Florette is Dynasty with a French accent and encompasses all of the seven deadly sins plus a few more besides. Galinette and César are two mean little farmers in the Provence of the 1920s who covet their neighbour's land, which has a much-prized spring running through it. When the neighbour snuffs it, thanks to them gripping him warmly by the throat one day, they plan to buy the land off the bloke who now owns it, Jean Cadenet, known as Jean de Florette. He's decided to move from the city to the country to have a go at the self-sufficiency lark. Jean, unfortunately, is a hunchback and a tax collector, the latter of the two obviously being the bigger handicap. The farmers aren't too happy about him moving in, and so, under the guise of being as sweet and friendly as a box on Langford's, they help him out. Unfortunately, they're as much use as a chocolate fire guard, and when drought means Jean's crops fail and he dies trying to dig a well, they are well chuffed. However, Jean's daughter Manon knows what they've been up to and swears revenge. The scenery is stunning and the tale gripping, and you'll love this if you can put up with the icky yellow subtitles.
Que la Providence nous envoie. Oh, merci. Oh, merci. C'est là-bas qu'il pleut.
The wonderful Jean de Florette. Also watch out for the sequel, Manon des Sources, out on the 17th of February. Right, I'm back after the break with Planes, Trains and Automobiles, Prayer for the Dying and My Best Friend is a Vampire.
Excuse me, but isn't that a Quaker Harvest bar?
Yeah.
Aren't you worried about the squirrels?
Not really. I might, you see.
Well, maybe it's the wheat, nuts, oats and honey. But what those squirrels won't do for a Quaker Harvest bar.
I know. Sad, isn't it?
Don't say I didn't warn you.
How to get on the wrong side of Frank Bruno.
Frankly, I'm not HP.
How to get on the right side of Frank Bruno. Only one sauce can give all Frank's favourite foods the necessary punch. So in a couple of shakes, he's completely HP.
A mother knows naturally what's good for her children. And caring for a baby comes so easily with new Produce. A new ultra-absorbent nappy with padding that's kinder to nature because it isn't chlorine bleached. New Produce, ultra kind, ultra plus. The most absorbent nappy Produce have ever made. But with all nature's children in mind.
Welcome back. From France now to the good old US of A for the hilarious Planes, Trains and Automobiles, another Steve Martin goodie. He's Neil Page, a man who wants only one simple thing in life, to get home from New York to Chicago in time to celebrate Thanksgiving with his family. But from the moment his cab is stolen by a stroppy yuppie, everything starts going rapidly downhill. His flight's diverted, his train breaks down, and in general he's getting as frustrated as Joan Collins without a boyfriend. To make matters worse, he's landed with the company of shower curtain ring salesman Dale Griffith, played by John Candy, the man who obviously thinks a well-balanced diet is three hamburgers in each hand. They end up home to share a smelly motel room for the night and then various forms of transport, hence the title, to get them home. Both hate the sight of each other and their irritating habits, but inevitably, as the movie drifts on, they grow grudgingly closer. The film's basically a buddy movie with lots of laughs, and Candy and Martin are a great comic pairing. It does lapse into typical American schmaltz at times, but thankfully that doesn't detract from the film in any way. Here's the two chaps getting all snuggly together.
I guess you're all fixed. So, there you are. Last room in the complex.
I mean, share?
Why did you kiss my ear?
Why are you holding my hand?
Where's your other hand?
Between two pillows.
Those aren't pillows.
And now the apparently controversial A Prayer for the Dying. Mickey Rourke is outstanding as an Irish terrorist who wants to give up fighting in a film that's intriguing and disturbing. But for most of the time, there's enough corn to put the Jolly Green Giant out of business. Honestly, the filmmakers must have raided the granny's jolly naughty book of baddies sayings for this one, because it often lapses into comic book cliches. Basically, Rourke is Martin Fallon, and he wants out of his violent lifestyle, but to get a passport and a new identity, he has to commit one more murder, this time for an East End gang boss. Whilst carrying out the dirty deed in a graveyard, he's seen by Father DaCosta, Bob Hoskins. But of course, as soon as he confesses his crime to the rotund reverend, an ex-SAS man of all things, DaCosta is bound by his Catholic vows to keep silent. It's a great and gripping story, but sometimes the script is so lame it needs a wheelchair. Bob Hoskins looks completely uncomfortable in a frock as he struggles to keep his Cockney accent down. Alan Bates, meanwhile, hams it up as the gangster boss Jack Meehan, an embalmer who hates ripping off little old ladies but is quite happy to pin colleagues to the wall using screwdrivers. Sammy Davis, on the other hand, had to contend with a really naff part as the portly priest's blind niece. She has some really stupid lines to say, such as when Fallon's playing the church organ to her, "You hide yourself, don't you, but not when you play." Well, yes, it would be a bit difficult to play if he was hidden 40 foot up a tree, wouldn't it? Anyway, how she knows how he plays with his organ is anybody's guess. Here's one of those terribly sincere scenes.
What's happened to this door?
Broke.
What do you mean, broke? What's going on here, Fallon?
Keep your voice down, Farr. Fallon's had a bad night.
intruder broke into the house.
Is she all right?
She's asleep. Don't disturb her for her.
Don't play games with her, Fallon.
I haven't played games for her, even when I was a kid.
I know why you keep coming here. And you know too, don't you? Martin, I've been exactly where you are now. You've made the choice. You've turned your back on the horror. But who's going to forgive you? Believe me, you cannot live without forgiveness.
Don't you ever give up for her?
Look, I'm trying to do my job. I'm trying to save your soul. And it's so easy. I know what you're feeling. But come with me now. Ask God for forgiveness. I swear you will be forgiven. Martin? Martin, please.
And finally, a vampire film you can really get your teeth into. My Best Friend is a Vampire sounds like a bad B-movie, but it's not such a pain in the neck as it sounds. Jeremy Capello's teenage life is pretty damn dull until he starts dreaming about a luscious girlie. When making grocery deliveries to a spooky mansion, he meets the girl, a vampiress, who gives him the sort of kiss to launch 1,000 AIDS adverts. Of course, he now turns into a vampire. He heaves near garlic pizzas, goes a most unhealthy colour, and turns down beer in favour of pints of B-negative pig's blood. But as if looking like a member of the damned wasn't punishment enough, there's a loony professor and a vampire hunter on his tail who wants to present him with a steak, and it's not the sort you have with chips either. There's quite a fun ending in this light-hearted vegetarian's nightmare of a romp, so obviously there are some compensations for being undead and preferring pig's blood to pina coladas. In this scene, the vampire hunters are just about to do something they might well regret.
May God have mercy on your soul.
Stop!
Hi. I know what this must look like.
How about attempted murder?
No, you're mistaken. We're just performing a little exorcism. This is a vile, disgusting creature of the night. A vampire. With the good guys.
You kill him and you'll fry for murder one, pal. Guaranteed.
No way. There won't even be a corpse. He'll crumble to dust before your very eyes. Watch!
Wait. If he is a vampire, that's one thing. If he isn't, an innocent guy is dead.
That's a chance I'm prepared to take.
Forget it. Let's see some proof. What's in your little vampire hunter's kit there? You have a crucifix, right?
Maybe he's a Jewish vampire.
Right. What else have you got?
String of garlic.
And you were gonna kill this guy? Holy water, right? Good idea. Nothing worse than a dirty vampire.
And the steak. If I kill him with a steak through the heart, he's definitely a vampire.
A steak through the heart would kill anything. I'm afraid this evidence wouldn't be too persuasive at your murder trial.
Grimsdyke, you've made a mistake. Let him go.
A mistake? That's all? No apology?
No, I'm sorry, Ralph. I beg your pardon, Ralph. Sorry about that stake through your heart, Ralph.
You sly little bloodsucker, you.
Ow!
Just before I dash off, we've got a wonderful Vice Versa skateboard for one of you lot to win. What we want to know in return for this lovely thing is the names of three other films that Judge Reinhold, the star of Vice Versa, has been in. It's not too difficult, is it? Write answers on a postcard, please, to Vice Versa Competition, Night Network, P.O. Box 90, London SE1 9PR by the end of the month. First one out of Tono's nosebag gets the skateboard. Right then, I'm off. You know the address for the Valentine's prezzies, don't you?
Called stained clothes in a basket.
Mum, that's not art, that's washing.
You've got more chance of shifting one of those paintings than getting shot of that.
Lentil casserole. Hasn't aerial liquid made it out to suburbia yet, then?
There are several things we don't do in Harrogate, dear. Trying to get out lentil stains with some wishy-washy liquid is just one of them.
Ah, but you can scrunge this liquid right into the fibres. So it starts working straight away.
I'd like to see the day anything starts working in this place.
And then you just stick your aerialette in your machine and plonk it on cool.
Typical student, always demonstrating.
So the liquid works right in the heart of the wash. There. Even Van Gogh never got his colours that bright.
He never had lentil casserole.
Aerial liquid, clean to the heart of the wash.
It's brilliant. Pity there's nowhere to hang it.
Baby face, I'm up in heaven when I feel your warm embrace. You sure have started something.
Johnson's Baby Lotion keeps your skin feeling baby soft.
Well, it's 8 hours. Two adults, two children, two pensioners.
Prudential pensioner.
Will your future have the clout of a Prudential pension? Prudential. We explain and arrange more personal pensions than anybody else.
All day, carting beer from pub to pub, and what do we get?
Water.
It's not even the Pennine water they use for brewing Webster's Yorkshire Bitter.
Oh, I can see it now. The rich chestnut glow.
With a head as white as a Yorkshire rose.
And that unsurpassable taste.
Have I got a treat for you?
Hey, up.
Yeah, no, just a move. Ooh.
It's right tasty, is Webster's.
Just say we were to look at the music that's come out of the States over the last year or so, i.e. Belinda Carlisle, Chicago or Whitney Houston, we'd probably be under the impression that United States music scene's run out of ideas. But if we were daring enough to have encountered the Pixies, Sonic Youth, Jane's Addiction or Throwing Muses, who inhabit the independent music scene, it's possible we may have realised that, creatively speaking, all is not lost. The thing is, though, we all know and love Belinda, Whitney and Chicago, but who are the Pixies, Jane's Addiction and Throwing Muses? Well, the Throwing Muses are a Boston band about to tour the UK with their breakthrough new album, Hunk Papa. And I've got two members of the group in the studio with me now tonight, Kristen Hirsch and Tanya Donnelly. Welcome.
Thank
so
you.
This breakthrough album, what are they saying? What do they mean by a breakthrough album? Are those your words or somebody else's?
They're not our words, but it might as well be.
People can listen to this one.
Yeah, right. It doesn't hurt anyone's feelings. It doesn't confuse anybody.
But as of before now, the sort of Throwing Muses have been well tucked away in a sort of independent scene, music that could jar and not be pleasant.
Yeah, that's true. We kind of began by creating our own musical language, and that tended to alienate people the farther we took it. We wanted to explore it as far as we could before we worked on simplifying it or purifying it so we could get to the skeletal core of all the structure and the song itself, lyrically and musically. We had to definitely simplify it.
That's great, though. That makes the independent music scene sound far more complicated than the mainstream.
Probably is.
Is it because there's far more of your personal control and sort of input, do you think?
It could be, yeah. I mean, we're not limited to standard pop format, standard song structure. Our natural language is what we're allowed to use, so we're allowed to do what we want with it.
Now, Throwing Muses, just to get a bit of history in there, you're almost an all-woman band. Were you ever an all-woman band?
Huh? Mm-hmm. Do that one.
Yeah, we
used to have a female drummer for a while who would scream real loud during our ballads. And
scream real loud?
Yeah.
Is that what
so
she's
basically,
no longer
she's
with you?
Gone.
No, I'm the only one allowed
pretty
to scream
much.
Real loud.
But you sort of formed in Boston, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we've got an image of Boston as being, you know, the place of the last great tea party, and a sort of very it's one of the most British sort of American cities, very sedate.
Yeah.
What sort of scene in Boston do you emerge from?
We kind of went through Boston pretty quickly, so we never really hooked into any real scene there.
The scene is a lot of diverse bands.
Yeah, it's
actually
very fragmented.
And
so there's no
come
real
from Boston as well, don't
yeah.
they?
Mm-hmm. Volcano Suns, Mission of Burma, Zeus.
But is there sort of a lot of clubs, a lot of club music, a lot of independent music going on there?
Yeah, well, there should
yeah.
be.
It's real, there's no cohesive scene. It's kind of all over the place right now. So it seems to be reforming because everything fell apart for a while. All the clubs closed and all the bands broke up.
It's a scene of mutual appreciation, so much as like stylistic appreciation. People are allowed to explore their own styles.
So what is this sort of image of Throwing Muses? I mean, does the name give anything away? What is that? Where did you take that from? It sounds like, you know, you looked in a dictionary and chose the first two words you saw.
No, that's not what we did, actually. We did find out that it's in a Heidegger poem, though, so it's better to say
it's
that.
What?
It's in a Heidegger poem. It's actually a sonnet, I think, and he talks about throwing muses. We didn't know that at the time, but it makes us sound literate.
And what about the title of the album, Hunk Papa, or how do you pronounce it?
Hunk Papa.
What's that?
That's a Teton Sioux tribe, Native American tribe, Sitting Bulls. So there's a better name than Winnebago.
Yes, right. Or bagel, even. But where do you draw your material from? You said that up until recently, you know, it was all very subjective and very to do with your own sort of communication with yourselves and not very easy for what would you call the masses to understand. Mm-hmm. But Kevin got through that sort of barrier. Where do you draw the sort of inspirations from now? What are you sort of writing about?
I still draw from the same inspiration, but I refuse to think of the masses as a big moron like everybody else treats them. I couldn't write for morons, and I don't want to think of them that
Why
way.
Why is it do you think that sort of people have an idea that the masses are morons and need to be spoon-fed?
It has a lot to do with, at least in America, the fact that you're not allowed to offend anyone. And because America holds every nationality, every kind of person, every culture, every economic standing, you have to be paced in order to please everyone. So it's hard. You have to find pockets and go as far as you can to please.
Do you think it also has to do with sort of record companies as well? Because you're now signed to a part of the great Warner Brothers empire on Sire Records. And surely there must come a pressure for them to say, look, you know, you're with us. You've got to make some money. We've got to sell some records.
Indirectly, they could, like, not sell our albums, but they wouldn't say, Chris, write a pop song. I think they'd sign a different band if they wanted to say that.
Yeah. I don't think they were expecting a record like this from us, really. It wasn't something we were pushed into. Mm. Sort of surprised all of them.
But you do sort of have a very personal message. I mean, are you singing? Because a lot of people in the mainstream sing about, you know, the usual sort of thing, you know, boy meets girl, girl meets boy, fall out, fall in, whatever. Yeah. But you're different from that, aren't you?
It's personal in that my most honest form of empathy is to take the piece of my brain that makes up other people's personalities. So I definitely find it within myself. But I don't say, and then I drop my toothbrush and my boyfriend broke up with me. And I mean, I don't want to sing about Kristen Hirsch.
If you heard someone say, look, you know, I just played that record in the background and I liked it, but I didn't really understand what it was all about, would that satisfy you?
I think music happens to you. I don't expect them to dig it apart with their minds. I think and we write it from our guts, and people should feel it in their guts. It's a thing that happens. You can tear it apart later and use your mind, but it doesn't affect the music.
There tends to be a big gulf between the sort of independent music scene here in the United Kingdom and the mainstream sort of pop charts. Mm-hmm. Is it sort of closer together in the States?
I wouldn't know. I don't really know what it's like here. Well, it's definitely far apart, but, you know, they're college charts.
It's more accessible,
charts,
though, isn't it?
What?
Well, all types of music through sort of college radio stations, etc.
College radio has definitely been a big push.
I mean, over here, there would only be a certain number of DJs that would play some of your earlier stuff anyway.
Yeah,
you have good press here, though, which makes up for that. Yeah. Our press isn't as open to...
But not a vast amount of people read that, really. I mean, it's quite good. We've got some good writers, but, you know, talking about thousands and not millions.
Yeah.
But why do you think people would sort of like throwing muses? What is it about them you feel is a sort of the powerful aspect of it? And I mean, the mainstream of people, as I say, not just sort of...
I think people are finding out that you can't reiterate the same thing, same style, the same lyrical content, and same hook. It really offends me, the idea that you pick one melody line and drill it into people's heads so that it annoys them so much they have to buy it. That just seems like very offensive to music itself to me.
Yeah. But what about pop music? Because would you not say that, you know, the idea of music, particularly for yourselves, is to get to as many people as possible?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. I think we made a lot of mistakes in alienating people, but we had to go through those stages so that we could approach people more honestly. I like standard pop format. I think that's a great approach to reach people on the first level so that you can pull them in and keep teaching them through the music. I just think people are being very rude to pop right now.
In what way?
I just think they're being unfair to the format. I think it offers a lot.
What do you mean, artists or public?
Artists.
What sort of people?
I'm going to offend everyone.
But what sort of people are being misusing?
Well, radio is only playing stuff that has fit the standard format for, you know, two decades now, and that's not fair. There's a lot of writing that should be top 40, that should be accessible pop that isn't being treated as such.
What about people who are sitting there now listening to what you're saying, thinking that's a load of old garbage, I just want to listen to something that I like?
Yeah.
I mean, are you saying it's their fault that they should be like that? Is there a fault in that sort of attitude?
I think that if good music was marketed as being immediately accessible and being able to take you to different levels, and there's a lot of music that does both. It's not like it has to be difficult. You could groove to something and be able to listen to it 10 years later and still have it affect you just as immediately as it always did. But I think there's a lot of top 40 music that will affect you once, and stylistically it'll be gone later and it won't be teaching you anymore.
You think people should sort of be more, what would you say, imaginative in their search for music rather than just sit back and let it happen to them?
I think radio should be available to them. Yeah.
Does have a lot of censorship here. So what about you're playing a tour here in the UK, and as I say, the new album is more accessible, if that's not a rude word to use. But where are you looking to for the next few years? Have you not already basically sort of obtained all those personal goals? Haven't you done all the things you wanted to do?
Oh, not at all. We're not nearly the band we want to be, and I love that. It's very exciting to us.
So where would you like to be? You know, what sort of emotions would you like to be dealing with? What sort of situations would you like to see the band in the next few years?
I wouldn't presume to know. I'm definitely dragged around by the ear by this music.
Yeah. You're not heading for big stadium rock or anything like that. You don't think you can revolutionize that for us, could you?
Yeah, sure. Give me a bag of money and we'll
And so the album's out. Is there anything particular about it that pleases you?
Yeah. I like it. I like the way we've purified our sound. We left a lot of space in it that we didn't have before. Mm-hmm. Space for people to be able to get into it more. I mean, we used to literally bombard them with counter melodies and lyrical elements.
Yeah, we've learned to play together, mm-hmm. instead of off each other, you know, mm. instead of responding to each other.
you're quite sort of, you know, musically and idealistically sussed. Are a lot of the bands in the independent scene in the States like this? Is it all quite a sort of a theoretical exercise? I mean, they say like rock and roll, it's playing from the hip, you know, it's sex and drugs. But independent music seems to be sort of playing from the,
Not at all. It's the opposite of what we do. That's what I was saying. I mean, I can talk about it. I can use my mind, but I never use my mind when I'm listening or writing or playing music. It's your guts. That's where real music
comes
from.
Okay, well, it's time for us all to use our guts. Kristen and Tanya, thanks a lot. Hope the tour goes well. Now's a chance for you to use your guts. Here's the first release from the Hunk Pepper album. It's a track called Dizzy.
Blue.
Clifford is quite the bon viveur. Tonight he's entertaining.
What?
An old flame. Luckily, strong-tasting Listerine antiseptic mouthwash kills the germs that can cause bad breath. And, a recent report shows, Listerine can also kill germs that form plaque. Okay.